Welcome to What's New with Grails 4. Thanks for coming. Hope you are enjoying the conference. My name is Sergio Del Amo. I am based in Guadalajara, the real Guadalajara in Spain, not the Mexico one. I have been working at OCI since January 2017, so almost 2 years and a half. I've been working on the Grails and Micronaut team, doing both open source and client projects. I write a newsletter called groovycalamari.com. It's a newsletter about Grails, Gradle, Micronaut, and basically the topics in this conference. So if you are attending this conference and you're having a good time, chances are that you will enjoy the conference. I started a podcast this year, actually. In the latest episode, I talked to Marcin Erdman, the project lead of JEP, who is in the conference, and I believe tomorrow has a talk at the same time as me. So if you don't come to my talk, come to his. I took over the baton of Grails Conference. It's a conference in Madrid. This year was in March. We covered Android, we covered Micronaut, Grails, topics around the Groovy ecosystem, more or less a sister conference to GRConf, and my Twitter handle and my blog. I'm going to be here until the end of the conference, so please, if you want to talk anything to me, please come and talk to me. In this talk, I want to talk about what's new in Grails 4. I want to basically describe the changes that you will need to do in a Grails 3 application to upgrade to Grails 4, and also talk about the Micronaut integration inside Grails 4, which is kind of a big feature of Grails 4. We actually started the upgrade a long time ago. The biggest push was at the end of last year, actually. I was working all December upgrading the several plugins in Grails 4. So a lot of effort was put in the team to start releasing milestones and release candidates during this year. The latest release candidate is more than a month old. So yeah, we are really close to the general availability release. So I encourage you to test your Grails application. This is the moment to give feedback and uncover bugs before releasing a stable release. So hopefully, after these talks, if you are maintaining Grails application, you will see the steps are not big. So hopefully you can give it a try. So several things have changed in Grails 4. The first one is, we finally deprecated Java 7, which is a really nice thing because many of the projects Grails is built on top of in the latest releases were no longer supporting Java 7. So if we wanted to upgrade to the newest version of Jeff, for example, or of or many other dependencies, we needed to get rid of Java 7. We have upgraded to, in their latest release candidate, I believe it's Groovy 2.5.6. I know there is Groovy 2.5.7. I don't think there is any major feature, but mostly bug fixes. Probably we will upgrade Grails 4 to the latest stable release before releasing. Also, a big update to Spring Boot. So Grails 3 was using Spring Boot 1.5, and now we are using Spring Boot 2.1. Same with Spring. Now we are, Grails 3 was using Spring 4. Now we are using Spring 5. Latest version of Gorm, if you install a Grails application with the latest stable in Grails 3, you will have Gorm 6. Grails 4 ships with Gorm 7. It supports, I believe, the minimum is Hibernate 5.3. Although if you install a new Grails application, you will see we are using Hibernate 5.4. Grails 3 applications are using Gradle 3.5 by default. We support unofficially Gradle 4 for Grails 3 applications. In Grails 4, when you create a new Grails app, we are using 5.1.1. I don't see any major things why we couldn't use the latest version of Gradle. So I think Grails for applications can be upgraded to, I believe the latest of Gradle is 5.4.1, so I don't think that should be an issue. We upgraded the dependency to Spock, and also to the integration with Micronaut. I will talk more about the integration later. The biggest takeaway for me of this talk is upgrading from Grails 3 to Grails 4. It's not the same as upgrading from Grails 2 to Grails 3. Grails 2 to Grails 3 was a big update. The build system changed. The plugin system changed. So it was a pain. And I have suffered the pain myself as well. So it's not the same. The upgrade path is much smaller. The upgrade path is, as we have just discussed, is upgrading to Grails is built on the shoulder of Giants, so we are upgrading the Giants versions. So if there are breaking changes, those breaking changes are going to come from Spring Boot or from Gradle. So don't fear the upgrade. So what has changed in Grails? So internally, if you are using code that was annotated with deprecated, so if you are using deprecated APIs, those deprecated APIs have been removed. So I will highlight some of the most important ones. But if you are using a deprecating API and you open your project in IntelliJ and your code was extracted through, now chances are it will not compile. So if that's, you will need to change that code. We have done some package restructuring to adjust to Java modules. Not a lot, but potentially some packages may have changed. Most plugins should just work out of the box. We have upgraded Spring Security Core. I will discuss later what you need to do. Spring Security Core depends on Spring Security, which has been upgraded as well, and has some breaking changes. So there are some breaking changes there. But as I was saying, the good thing about Grails is it's built on top of big names. The bad thing about Grails is built on top of big names. So whenever there are breaking changes on those big names, there are breaking changes on your Grails applications. Even if you can go and use a Grails application without realizing that Spring is being used, it is used. So first thing you will need to change in your application is you should have a gradle.properties in the root of your project with the Grails version specified. It should say probably something like 3.3.9 right now or 3.3.10. So you will just set the version to release candidate 1, or when release comes, it will be 4.4.4 release. And that will automatically upgrade the Grails bomb and does all the dependencies, all the Spring dependencies. So in a Grails build.gradle file, you don't see the Spring dependency explicit there, but it's coming from the Grails bomb. So you control that with that. Spring Boot has several breaking changes, especially in configuration. Also in the use of embedded container API. So if you are using the embedded container API, you may have some breaking changes, and there are some notable changes in the endpoints, so in the actuator. By default, when you create a Grails 3 application, you have the left-hand side configuration. We disable endpoints by default. The configuration names for the actuator have changed in Spring Boot 2.1, so you will need to change that. Especially if you are using something like the health endpoint, which many of us use, and you have something like pingdom pointing to your application, actuator endpoints are prefixed by default now with actuator. So if you don't change and you set up the correct prefix, the health endpoint will be now exposed in actuator/health. Instead, if you want to be /health, you need to change, I believe it's called context path or something like that, to have it in the root folder. So if you are using the actuator, please read the changes in the actuator. If you are not using it, from going the configuration will be the one displayed in this slide. So this is like the default configuration in Grails is actuator endpoints are not enabled, so this is just the small change. Hot reloading. So Grails 3 was using spring loaded when it worked, which sometimes it didn't. Spring loaded is kaput. They move it to the attic, it's no longer used. The recommendation is to use spring dev tools. So in Grails for applications, we recommend you to use spring dev tools. This is the necessary configuration changes you need to put in your build file. And I recommend you to use this in combination with a Chrome plugin, something like Chrome Live Reload. The dev tools are like hot reloads. So if you are using some in-memory things, the reload is not as user-friendly as it used to be, but it works. And spring-loaded sometimes, when it worked really well, but sometimes it didn't work and you didn't know why. So this is like the way forward. There are some spring changes. I don't anticipate most users of Grails 3 applications, if you are not doing anything fancy with Spring, you shouldn't be impacted. But there are changes in Spring itself. So check it out. Gradle. So I was saying before, Grails 3 shipped with Gradle 3. They were breaking changes from Gradle 3 to Gradle 4. We had all the infrastructure in Gradle 3. But we did some changes to support Gradle 4. But all our tests was being run in Gradle 3, so it was always a bit tricky. So the path forward in Grails 4 is to use Gradle 5. If they are breaking changes for 3 to 4, from 3 to 5, there are even more. So if you are doing anything fancy with your Gradle build, this is an area where you could have maybe some work to do. So in our regular Grails applications, if you didn't touch the build.gradle file, there would be almost nothing to do, probably nothing. But if you, all of us, change a little bit the Gradle file, so yeah, take a look because there might be some work there. There are also some work in the plugins. So Grails uses the Spring Boot Gradle plugin. And one thing that by default, when you install, when you create a Grails app, you have their resources through. This is now removed in the Spring Boot Gradle plugin, and this is actually the recommended replacement. So Spring Boot Gradle plugin has changed. If you have used some other features which are not the ones out of the box, there might be other changes, but this is a change that you will face. Another change that you will face is this, when you create a Grails plugin, when you create a Grails 3 plugin, we disable the building of executable jars by default. But this, again, has been renamed. So what previously was boot repackage, now is boot jar, and there is a boot war. So those properties have changed in the Spring Boot Gradle plugins, so you need to change them. If you are not creating your own Grails plugins, you will not be affected, but if you create a new plugin from scratch, you will see this configuration rate change, but if you are like upgrading your plugin, this is something that you will need to change. Gorm. So Gorm, Grails 4 ships with Gorm 7, 7.0.1, I believe. Even if it's a major release, it doesn't have a ton of breaking changes. It has a couple, and it has the deprecation of the REST client builder. I will show you an example of that, and I will show you an example of the most impactful ones. So as well as with Grails code, all the Gorm code which was annotated with at deprecated has been removed. So if you are using deprecated APIs, those are gone. Some package restructuring has been done as well in order to support Java modules. Not a lot, but yeah, those changes are in place. One potentially surprising change is the changes to the proxy handler. So Gorm no longer creates custom proxy factories. Or one thing that you are gonna see more often is that it doesn't automatically unwrap Hibernate proxies. Let me show you an example which clarifies things. So this is Grails 3 code. So you have a pet class, you have a dog, which extends from pet. So you have a hierarchy there. And then you have a person class with a pet, a one relationship to pet. So here you could do person.get, and you could do an instance of pet, and the proxy was unwrapped for you. So this instance of was a valid instance of. Note here, this is not a typo, but there is a method in Gorm, domain classes, called instance of. So this you can use as well, but the regular instance of Java will work whether you use it, you fetch directly the pet, or you fetch the pet from an association. In Grails 4, that's no longer the case. This instance of will not work. So if you are relying on this behavior, this behavior will be broken for you now. So this proxy will not be unwrapped by default. So this change has been made in order to align closer with the default behavior of Hibernate. So Gorm was actually going a bit on its own and changing the default behavior of Hibernate and putting some extra effort in the Gorm. So this has removed this unwrapping by default. So yeah, if you are using, especially this in hierarchies, it's even trickier. So yeah, if you are doing this kind of instance of, bear in mind this may be the issue. Grails validation. So there was a bit of duplication because there was the old Grails validation module, and the same behavior was also in Gorm. So the Grails validation module is gone, and now the Gorm validation module is used. So this is the whole module that powers the constraints blocks. So yeah, this now lives in Gorm. And another one, this is another that you are gonna probably see, is to put it mildly, we Grails developer were really, we took our liberties working with transactions, and we had a lot of times light domain access. We were like using domain classes, doing queries in controllers without any transactional, any read-only, calling, doing queries in tag libs without any transaction. So Hibernate, I believe it's starting for 5.2 and above, is much more strict regarding access without a transactional demarcation. So it's now really important that you review your code. Even it will have also performance benefits. So if you are using, if you are doing like read operations, it has a lot of performance benefits to annotate that with a transaction. We have actually the add read only annotation, which is a synonym for transactional read only equals true. So go ahead, review your code. Even if you don't upgrade to Grails 4, using proper transaction demarcation is gonna help. If you upgrade to Grails 4 and you start seeing something like a transaction required exception, that's why. So you are probably missing a transactional annotation. So remember, if you are doing a select, add read only. If you are writing or deleting a transaction. So what do I need to do to upgrade Gorm? So when you create a new Grails 4 app, we have changed the property name actually. This used to be Gorm uppercase version. Now it's Gorm.version. So just remove the Gorm uppercase version and put this one. And then if you go to build.gradle, at the top in the build script dependencies, the Gorm version was referred to, you will need to upgrade that. So I believe the one you will need right now in build script dependencies will be 0700, And the one in Gradle property will be 701. So my advice is create a fresh Grails for app and see the values there at the time you are doing the upgrade. I mean, it's just changing some numbers. This is like a minor upgrade, but this is what you will need to change to upgrade GORM. And you will need also, if you are using the GORM for Hibernate implementation, you will need to upgrade the Hibernate version. So this will be the value that you will have right now. You will need to upgrade to 5.4. So with this, we'll take care of upgrading GORM. The removal of the REST client builder. No. Grails validation is via the GORM. I believe that's a splitted module, so the module is this depend. Yeah, it's a splitted module.
Okay,
yeah.
So
yeah. Is the Grails Data Store GORM validation. This one.
Yeah.
No. There are a couple of things that were duplicated in Grails and GORM and have been removed from Grails. So the REST client builder, I personally used it a lot in tests. So normally when I wrote a service which communicated with a third party API, I will use something like OK HTTP or something like that. But in tests, I use it a lot. Deprecated complete. It's actually possible to use it in Grails 4. You have to like load a dependency. But I personally will recommend you to move away from it. So there is no development being done on Grails Data Store client. So this is an example from the website, actually. This is like a put request. And you see it has like this is the Micronaut one. This is like the code from the REST client builder. So this is like a put request. And it used some of the Groovy DSL features. So if you wanted to use basic auth, you will use auth here, and you can pass the username and password, and it will take care of doing like user colon password base64 encoded and putting in the authorization header. You could supply like a JSON payload. The Micronaut code is similar, and the Micronaut HTTP client is much more tested and actually fully developed. So we support as well a fluent API. We support also utility methods. So we have an equivalent to the other one. We have one called basic auth. We have also another one called bearer, where you can supply like a JWT. We have as well content type. We have header. So if you don't have like a standard content type header, you have like my company header name, you can use like header key value. Only trickiest part, the most tricky migration part will be the way Micronaut handles non-200 responses. So Micronaut HTTP handle will throw an exception when you got like a 401 or a 400. So you need to capture the exception. Spock captures exceptions really fine. So it's just getting used to whenever when you had a 401, you will have a 401 in the response object, right? In Micronaut, you will have to capture an exception, so it will be an HTTP client response exception, and then in the exception object, you will do exception.response, .status, and you will have the 401 there. You can bind, Micronaut HTTP client supports binding like an okay, so mostly when you work with an API, you have like, I expect a payload to be response, to be responded if everything goes fine, and if there is an error, a different object will be sent. So we support that. So here in this example, I don't have, here I am mapping I am actually not even mapping the response. So if I wanted to map the response payload, I will add here a comma, and then I will have here an argument for the response payload that I expect. If you want, you can have like success, comma, and error type. So you can map the error type as well. So working with non-OK, you will have to use more capturing exception with the Spock. But we have migrated all the tests in all the modules from the old REST client builder to Micronaut HTTPB. It's a little bit of work, but it's doable. So I believe Grails 3 is using 2.4. In 2.5, there is no more an old jar, which is good because it was causing some issues with transitive dependencies. There is a way to bring actually all the jars using there's like a POM with all, Paul can probably explain better than me, but there is a way to bring all the jars that we used to do, but there is not like a single jar with all. So there might be applications where you will need to bring an extra dependency, an extra Groovy dependency, especially I believe if you are working with dates, you may need to bring one. Groovy brings also some nice features in 2.5. There are a lot of annotations, AST transformations. So check them out because they simplify code a lot. Plugins. Plugins should work unless you are using something like, for example, Grails Domain Class. Grails Domain Class was an API used to retrieve information on domain classes about what kind of persistent properties they have and stuff like that. That was actually deprecated in 6. There is another API, which is the persistent entity API, which is an API exposed by GORM. So there was a moment where both Grails and GORM were doing the same thing. They were all like mapping domain classes. When this was deprecated, actually the Grails domain class was calling the persistent entity methods. So what we have done is the Grails domain class is gone. So the recommended way to go is to use the persistent entity API. There is a section in the documentation with the necessary steps to migrate from one to the other one. So if you in your application are using the Grails domain class, check it out. It should be easy to move from one to another. So by default, when you install a new Grails app, Grails is really modularized. We see if you install like a web profile, we see with some plugins. One of the plugins is the JEP plugin. We used to ship by default with JEP 1 because JEP 1 was JDK 7 compatible and JEP 2 is JDK 8 or above compatible. So in order not to break, we had two features actually. So when you created a Grails application, you could choose. If you didn't specify, we'll use the JEP feature. If you specify JEP 2, because you didn't want to support JDK 7, we will bring the updated. So the JEP plugin has a transitive dependency to JEP Spock. So this is where the version of JEP is specified. So you could actually, for example, exclude the dependency here and use the other one. I believe tomorrow JEP 3 is going to be released, or if it's not released yet. So we'll probably ship with JEP 3 by the time Grails 4 ships. This means updating the dependencies. So we have moved from using HTML unit. You can use HTML unit with JEP 2. It still works. But myself, I find it really buggy in the moment you work with anything with JavaScript. So right now, there are two good alternatives for working with headless browsers, which are both Chrome and Firefox. Both have headless alternatives and are really easy to configure. So we ship with the Chrome and the Firefox dependencies. We also configured a Gradle plugin to download the drivers for you. So this will take care of downloading the Chrome driver and the Firefox driver. If you use Gradle, it will be transparent. If you are using the IntelliJ JUnit Runner, you may need to specify the path to the drivers. That's why we included we allow you to pass these system properties specifying the path to the driver. If you use the previous plugin, that will not be necessary, but we are shipping those by default. And the plugin includes as well this block, this extension block, where you specify the version of the driver that you are using. Another thing that we ship is we ship a JEP config file. So JEP supports the concept of environments. We have the development environment, we have the test environment. JEP supports the concept of environments as well. So you can run your test in Chrome and see what's happening. And then when you run them in continuous integration server, you configure them to run with Chrome headless. So this will be run my integration test. This is like this Gradle feature to when you don't have a collision in a Gradle task. So this will be integration test task. So you can supply the JEP environment, and you can choose which driver do you want to use to run your JEP tests. So we ship all of these. So this is already in Grails 3 when you create a new version. In Grails 4 will be with the latest version of JEP by default. So we will no longer have two profiles. We'll only have one profile, the JEP profile, which will bring you the latest one. Another really common plugin is the Asset Pipeline plugin. So you need to go and update your build.gradle file. One thing is the apply plugin has changed. So make sure to change the apply plugin. Not just the version number, both in the build script dependencies and in the project dependencies, but also change the apply plugin. Spring Security Core. So we have a version compatible with Spring, with the latest Spring Security. So this is the version right now, is a release candidate 2 of the plugin. So you will need to change your version of the Spring Security Core plugin. If you still are using service injection in your domain classes, this was deprecated in Grails 3 already. But if you are still using this, go ahead and do this change, which will be the change that when you do, like, if you do Grails create app, you install the Spring Security Core plugin and you do Grails S2 quick start, example, my company, user role, this will generate like the user class without all this code. Instead, it will create a password encoder listener. So whenever you modify your password or you create a domain class with a password, before this is safe, so these listeners are synchronous, it will basically encrypt the password for you. So if you have not done this change, go ahead and remove this code from your domain class and create a listener instead. So domain class service injection was deprecated due to performance issues. So if you loaded 1,000 users from the database, you needed to inject a service in each of those users. So domain classes were not singletons. So you could potentially have like 1,000 users with 1,000 services injected. When you create the listener, you will need to register the bin. So the listener will be in source main, blah, blah, blah. And then you go ahead, you modify your resources.groovy, and you create a bin. So in the Spring, bins are named. So this will be like the bin name and the class that implements the name, the bin. And this is a tricky change. So you will need to do this thing. So by default, you will probably be using bcrypt. If you are using a Spring Security Core, you will need to modify your password column in the database and prefix with bcrypt. So you are specifying the algorithm that you use. So this is an internal change that the Spring Security code team, I guess they put it so that they are able to have like databases with passwords that were created with different algorithms on time, and when a new, more secure, if you upgrade, instead of using bcrypt, there's like a fancy super bcrypt. A year from now, you will have like some entries in the database with the old bcrypt and some with super bcrypt. So update the dependency. I recommend you to move the password encoding to a listener, and you will need to do this. Password column modification. So, yeah, the Spring Security Core migration is you have to read the changes. So, now into Micronaut and Grails integration. So we like to when we talk about Micronaut, we like to say it's a foundation library. So it's we think about just Grails is more an above layer, and Micronaut is more low level. With Micronaut, you can build applications. You can build like command line interface applications. You can build functions that you deploy to AWS Lambda. You can build microservices suited to IoT. You can build completely like message-driven applications without a server. And it's focused really in low memory profile and low memory consumption. The team is obsessed about removing reflection. We are doing a lot of things on compile time to get rid of reflection, to get rid of runtime proxies. Everything is done on compile time. And this brings a lot of improvements also in startup time and also like in regular execution and in memory consumption. So we didn't want to replace Spring with Micronaut because that will break Grails applications completely. So that was not an alternative. So what has been done for Grails 4 is Spring application context allow you to define a parent context. So the Micronaut application context is the parent context of your Spring application context in a Grails application. So with time, components of Grails, internal components of Grails, will be migrated to be Micronaut beans. The idea is the less Spring beans you will have in a Grails application, the faster it will load. There are also performance improvements in Spring itself. So when you have a Grails, when you upgrade to Grails 4, you should see performance improvements coming from both sides. Which features can you use from Micronaut? You can use all the RabbitMQ, Kafka, all the messaging technologies available. And basically everything that, so Grails applications use the servlet API. Micronaut applications doesn't use the servlet API. So basically any feature that uses the Micronaut server is not available for Grails applications. All the features that don't use the Micronaut server should be available in Grails for applications. So that includes all the messaging system, but also the HTTP client, and many more. I'm gonna show you an example about using the HTTP client. So this is a real endpoint. So this is the Grails application forge, which I hope you guys know about, the star.grails.org. Which allows you to generate a zip file with a Grails application and that you can invoke it with a curl command. It has an API, it has an open API and authenticated and anything. So if you do this request in your computer, you should get a list of the available Grails versions. So if you wanted to have a Grails application which consumes this API, you could add the Micronaut the compile dependency to the Micronaut HTTP client. It's not required, but let's be good programmers and create an interface and code against the interface. We create an interface to return the list of the versions. And then I can create another interface which extends the previous one, so the type, annotate it with that client. I can put here the URL, and here this is a get endpoint. And I can have like the return type. Micronaut HTTP client supports reactive return types. Here I'm doing like a blocking call to get a list of strings. And now in my controller, so this will be a Grails controller. The only thing is I will need to annotate it without a wire. So typically when we inject services in Grails, we don't use auto wire, we inject by name. In this case, you will need to use AutoWire. You will need to use the AutoWire annotation from Spring. And you are good to go. You are able to use the Micronaut HTTP client in a Grails 4 app. And since I told you before that we deprecated the REST client builder, you can use the Micronaut HTTP client in the test as well. So here in the test, this is an integration test in Grails. So this will start the Grails app in the test. The server port thing that appears to be magic here, this is the port where the Grails application will be started in a random port. And this is exposed here in your test so that you can use the port where your app is really running. So this to blocking call here, this is something that I always do because, in the test, you normally don't care about blocking. You actually probably want to block. So this is really typical to create a client and block. And then before I show you Exchange, if you don't care about the HTTP response wrapper and you just care about the return type, so I'm telling bind the body to a string, you just use retrieve instead. So two methods normally you will work either with Exchange when you would like HTTP response of a string, and if you just want the string, you use retrieve there. You can use also the configuration options for the HTTP client. So normally you will not work with a hard-coded URL here, as I was showing you here. Normally, you will use with a client identifier. So you use a client identifier, and you can have like multiple instances of that. So if you have like, imagine we have like three servers running the Grails application forge, you can have a client identifier and have a list of URLs, or use like a discovery service. So here I am setting the client identifier to be a forge, and now in configuration here, I can have this in my Grails configuration, I can have my account HTTP service, and for the client identifier I forge, here I use a single URL, but I could have a list of URLs. So should I build a plugin or should I build a Micronaut configuration? If you need or want to provide your users with features such as JSON views or tag lips, you have to do a Grails plugin because those features are not available in a Micronaut configuration. So if your plugin provides value by offering the user a tag lib, go with a Grails plugin. But if you don't have such a need, we recommend you to write a Micronaut configuration. So imagine, so here in the European Union, we have the value added tax number, right? And we have a concept called intracommunitary operators. So when I create a company in Spain, by default, I am not an intracommunitary operator. I have to apply to basically get a number. And if I do a sale to a company here in Denmark, and if they are an intracommunitary operator, then I have to remove the VAT number. So there is like a SOAP message to provide with a list, to basically you send your VAT number and they tell you if your VAT number is good or bad. So this is a common use case. I was researching the other day the plugins.grails.org, and we have a couple of similar plugins which are just a service exposing some cool functionality. So here, for example, I have this service, which is really nice because it uses a Groovy library to abstract complexity from SOAP. So of course they did this in the European Union and they created a SOAP service to validate intracommunitary operators. So you have to do a SOAP request. So basically, if you abstract yourself from SOAP, the method is really simple. You supply like the country code and the company number, and this thing returns you whether it's good or bad, right? So imagine if you are creating like a Grails SOAP and you need to create invoices, you will need something like this probably in place. So instead of creating a Grails plugin, what we advise you to do, if you don't need tag lips or JSON views, create a simple Groovy library where you put the plugin as you have it there. Add the dependencies. So this is the same dependencies that you will need to compile the code. This is the same Groovy WS Lite dependency for the SOAP thing, which needs also the Groovy XML dependency. Add this compile only dependency, which will use AST transformations to generate everything inside for Micronaut on compile time. And the only change that you will need to add to your code that you used to have in a Grails plugin is you, for example, annotate this with at singleton. So that is considered a bin in the Micronaut application context. So then, in my Grails application, I could use my bat service as I was using it before, coming from a plugin, just with AutoWire. And my benefit is I would be able to use this bat service in a, this is a Micronaut application. So this is in a Micronaut controller, I will be able to use the same code. So if I am a library author, I am creating something that is useful for Grails application and something that is useful for Micronaut applications. And as you saw, the only thing that I changed in my code was an add singleton annotation. But what if I want to use this in a Spring Boot application? So imagine if I have a Spring Boot application and I need to basically tell the package to scan because my VS validator is in this package. If I want to use this in a Spring Boot controller, right? So this is a Spring Boot controller with request mapping, REST controller, blah, 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 get. I will use the same way as I will use it in the Grails application with the AutoWire. I need to add, in Micronaut we have a library called Micronaut Spring. The idea is, I have here this dependency, the Spring Framework, Spring Boot started dependency as compile only. I have it as compile only because I need this dependency. I am not using any Spring classes or any Spring implementations. So I am using, or any Spring interface, I am using only the annotation. I am going to use only the add service annotation. So what I have done, in order to have my code be, in order to use this code in a Grails application, in a Micronaut application, and in a Spring application, I, instead of using that singleton, which is an annotation that the Spring will not recognize, I am using a native Spring annotation. So I am using add service. And I am adding both this annotation to resolve the annotation and the Spring Micronaut annotation. The Spring Micronaut annotation will do some, so will detect that it will treat the Spring annotations as like a kind of a DSL for an application. So we'll say, okay, I see this add service annotation and I will transform it into an add singleton annotation in a Micronaut app. So as you see, it's possible and easy to use to create the same code and as a library author to say with a Grails, with a Micronaut and with a Spring application. Of course, the example that I show you here is really, really easy. I know I'm running out of time. I don't have much left, so. The example that I show you is really easy. If you only had a service, probably it's easier just to make the user instantiate the service and that's it. But in Micronaut, we have really nice things to create bins. We have things like really nice factory supports. We have the possibility to load bins conditionally. So we have the add required annotation, which will allow you to load a bin, for example, if only if some classes are present on your class path, or only if some bins are present in the application context, or only if a particular condition is fulfilled. We also have quite a big difference is the replaces. In Spring, all bins are named. So if you want to replace a bin in a Grails app, for example, you will typically use go to resources.groovy and put like the same name and a different class that you want to replace. In Micronaut, we replace bins by type. So you will need to use the add replaces annotation. So if you have a cool code that you want to share with the community, if you are not using taglibs or JSON views, consider making a library compatible with all three frameworks, because that will give you more exposure potentially. So summary, I hope that you saw that the changes from Grails 3 to Grails 4 were in a 45 minutes presentation. So those are the changes that you require to do in your application. So it's a much easier path to upgrade. I hope that you saw how you can access Micronaut features easily, and how you can like integrate consume bins from your controllers in an easy way. I'm open for questions. I don't blame them. Are you guys Grails users? Are you considering upgrading to Grails 4? If not, why are you not considering upgrading to Grails 4? Thank you, guys.